Hey guys, welcome to my channel. My name is Valentine Lister, and this is the weekly tarot and astrology forecast for Sunday, November 21st through Saturday, November 27th. And it looks like this week we have a real spotlight on Sagittarius and the South Node, and we'll be ending out the week with the last quarter moon. So I'm gonna walk you all through it, let you know what's happening, let you know the juice. And at the end, I'm going to do a tarot card reading to let you know how to navigate the energies for this week, so you don't lose your mind. All right, but before we get started, I just wanna let you know about a super awesome discount that I'm offering on readings with me. So right now you can get $20 off your very first reading. And all you need to do is go to my website, valentinelister.com. And when you go to book your reading, make sure to enter the discount code 20 bucks to get $20 off of your very first reading. And that offer is good until December 31st, 2021. Real quick, what do I offer? I offer tarot card readings, birth chart readings, a combination of both. Birth chart readings are generally better for understanding what your fate or your destiny is, what the stars had to say about your life, and what would happen, like in terms of love, relationships, children, marriage, career, your work, what you were meant to do in this life, you know, like who you are. And it's also good for figuring out what's coming up next for you. So I do some transit forecasting there as well. Tarot card readings are better for specific advice. If you have a really specific question, you want to know, you want to have some guidance on it, want to know what to do, tarot card readings are better for that. And I offer these readings on Zoom, one-on-one chat. It's a live session with me where we meet together. So you can book that at valentinelister.com. Use the code 20 bucks by December 31st, 2021. And I'm going to put the info in the description box below underneath the timestamps so you can see it there and get a little more info. Okay, so the first transits that we have are on Sunday, November 21st. We have both Mercury sextile Pluto, and then we have the Sun ingressing into Sagittarius later. So first, early in the morning, we'll have Mercury sextile Pluto. So we have the god of mischief, trickery, games, navigating between realms, so communication, business, the markets, in a harmonious relationship with Pluto. So the sextile was related to Venus. So in this aspect, in this relationship with Pluto, as it currently stands on Sunday, Mercury will have a very harmonious, pleasurable, pleasant exchange with Pluto, which really is no surprise. So Pluto is the god of the underworld. He's an earth god. He's actually related to fertility. He's related to the underworld. And so with Pluto, when we have a Pluto transit, what we have come up could be your worst nightmare, or it could be your greatest dream, because Pluto represents heaven or hell. But it's what you've pushed underground, underneath, like generally the surface of your consciousness, things that you thought you could get away with or hide, or secret dreams or desires that you've really pushed down and hidden, suddenly coming up. So overall, like Mercury and Pluto, they get along really well anyway, like in as far as, you know, mythology and the stories, like Mercury went between realms. He could go to heaven, earth, down to the underworld, and he would either like bring people back and forth between the realms, or, you know, he'd bring messages or whatever it was. So he was super cool with Pluto. So we could think about Mercury sextile Pluto as revealing some trickery and mischief in relation to things that are underground, that are hidden. So like having having something revealed that we didn't know about before, and having this element of like mischievousness around it. So some examples of what could happen is like finding out a secret about like someone that's close to you. Like, for example, I had this transit come through and I found like a birth certificate for a family member. And of course, as an astrologer, I'm like, I'm gonna look up their birth chart information and like find out all about them. I was super excited, but it was a little dark. It was a little mischievous, but it was definitely something that I wanted to know about, that I kept hidden, that I'm not gonna like aggravate people to find out their birth chart information, but I was super excited to find it. Another example is like, you could have some like emergency. Like I had a friend who helped somebody with a medical emergency and it was like super comical. I'm not going to go into too much detail. So this is a person I know that's close to me, but it was like a super comical thing. The person ended up being okay, but it was also super gross. And it was super gross in a way where my friend, like that's like his worst nightmare to deal with, you know, had to do with like bodily functions. But it ended up being really funny, even though it was an emergency and a real fear. So like that mischievousness quality with that darkness quality is what we want to think of. We can also think of people in the media doing something mischievous or provocative. Somebody doing a news report in the media on something where people are like, oh, no, you didn't. I can't believe that person even went there. In the media, like say the person is like on the left and then they like branch out and cover something that's like super right leaning, or someone on the right goes to the left and covers something super left leaning and people are like, oh no, they didn't. Or they're on the right and they go super extreme where they're like, that's too far. If it's on the left, like, I can't believe you reported on that. They go super extreme on the left. Too far. But examples of that you might see on TV where you're like, I can't believe they reported that and that seems extreme, and oh no, they didn't. And on that Sunday, we also have the sun ingressing into Sagittarius later that day, as I mentioned. So that's going to be interesting. And it's interesting because the sun is going to move right into conjunction with the south node, and is going to make an exact conjunction, a kazemi, later in the week. So first, let's just look at the sun in Sagittarius. So the sun represents the truth. Illuminating things, shedding light on things, what our soul is pushing us to do. And it can also relate to leaving a legacy, because the sun is related to what is eternal. And so the sun can relate to fathers, leaders, spouses, people we look up to lead us in some way, both in our personal lives and in our public lives. And now it's moving into Sagittarius, which is actually a pretty good spot for the sun, but then it's moving into this south node conjunction, which is gonna kind of dampen its light a little bit. So the sun in Sagittarius, I have the sun in Sagittarius, so why don't I talk about myself? Because Sagittariuses love to talk about themselves. But anyway, the way that I think about the sun in Sagittarius is being moved, and taking action in your life, because the sun also represents the actions that we take in our life, being moved in a way that you follow what your soul wants you to do, what your inner light guides you to do, and it's just pure inspiration. So in general, as a Sagittarius sun, sun in Sagittarius is not thinking things through. So that's more of a Mercury thing, and that'll be interesting because later Mercury is going into Sagittarius. I am not thinking things through. I'm thinking that I want to live my truth. I want to do what my soul is guiding me to do. I want to do things that are inspiring, and it leads me on lots of adventures, lots of crazy things, making a lot of mistakes. A lot of times people think I'm super brave, but I maybe that's true, maybe that's not, but it has nothing to do with bravery necessarily. It has to do with following my heart's calling and the things that are inspiring, because there is something, some knowledge with the sun in Sagittarius that we only have this life to live, even if we have multiple lives. And, you know, I do believe in reincarnation. This life, I have an opportunity to really experience life deeply and to the fullest. And there's also something about having, like gaining wisdom through experience. So with the sun in Sagittarius, it's a Jupiter ruled sign. It is the masculine element of Jupiter. And so Jupiter represents wisdom, but it's not wisdom that you just gain quickly, like book knowledge or something. Jupiter moves super slow in the sky. So Saturn is like the slowest moving of the seven like personal planets. And then we have Jupiter, which also moves super slow. So with Jupiter, we also have something that is gained slowly over time, that wisdom is gained over time and it is gained through experience. So Sagittarius is related to the centaur. And it's kind of interesting because we have kind of two things so Sagittarius is related to the centaur Chiron, who was super wise, who taught like the gods and goddesses children. And then we have the centaurs that like ruined parties. You could think of them as like a biker gang, where they would drink, they would party, they would womanize, they would get into fist fights. And I was thinking today about how like those two things come together, where somebody could be so wild and crazy, like with Sagittarius, but then be so wild as well. And I realized that it actually goes together exactly well, because of that element of gaining wisdom through experience. So with Sun in Sagittarius, you might be pulled and called to do some wild things, being just in the spirit of the moment and like following what inspires you, what your soul's calling is, and doing some wild and crazy things that are super spontaneous, super synchronous, super in the moment. And then also having the wisdom to step back and going, that was worth it. That was an experience that I'm going to treasure forever. And I gained wisdom. I learned something from that experience. So that experience is always good, because as a Jupiter ruled sign, you know, Sagittarius is related to just that bigger picture, that meaning in life, like putting all the puzzle pieces together. It's also a time where you might choose to spend time with friends, because Jupiter is related to friendship. You could also have this element of morality and self-righteousness and fighting a lot. Remember, it's a body center, so that biker gang, it's like, I have wisdom through experience and you're gonna listen to me. And if you don't agree, I might fight with you, but then it's all good in the end. Like we'll have a fist fight and then we'll hug after, kind of energy to it. So quickly, I wanna get to the Sun making a conjunction with the South Node. And actually this moves us right into going into Tuesday and just continuing this Sun in Sagittarius theme. But the Sun will be making an exact conjunction with the South Node. And so we can call this like a South Node Kazemi, even though the South Node is not an actual planet, but it's a point that's going to be highlighted and in the center of the Sun. So let me tell you about the South Node. So I'm a traditional astrologer, a Hellenistic Western astrologer. And also through my experience, I view the South Node very differently from modern astrology. So in modern astrology, the South Node is considered your comfort zone, where you want to move out of. In ancient astrology, and this includes sidereal astrology and Hellenistic astrology, the South Node is considered a demon. It's a malefic force. And I can definitely vouch for that, having observed the transits in my life and other people's lives. So the South Node is related to Ketu and the North Node Rahu. And basically, it's like the head of the demon is Rahu and the body of the demon is Ketu. And so this demon messed up. He tried to fool a goddess and eat this like ambrosia that would make him live eternally or make him go to heaven, whatever it was. And the goddess was like, oh, hell no, I'm a goddess. I know what you're up to. And she cuts the demon's head off. And so Rahu, the North Node, represents this endless hunger of like eating and eating and eating and not feeling full, whereas Ketu just represents this body without a head and generally represents escapism. So it could be related to escaping into a spiritual practice, being a hermit, not wanting to deal with life on life's terms. It could be related to addiction. In general, it's related to wanting to escape the world. So generally we think of like, you know, someone going deep into their spiritual practice and meditating all day and going like really extreme with it, or like people in addiction in some way escaping the world. But there's all kinds of ways that we might try to escape. It could be somebody losing themselves in like artistic type ventures as well. So with the South Node Kazemi and it being in a Jupiter ruled sign in Sagittarius, we could really see like you might see yourself or other people go overboard with spiritual practice because Sagittarius is definitely related to spiritual practice because it's related to Jupiter, who is the head of the gods and who is like the ultimate god to go to for wisdom. So yeah, it could be extreme in meditation or listening to beautiful music, or losing yourself in like the spontaneity of the moment, being pulled to something that seems like a fun experience, or it's so beautiful, or, seems so synchronous, escaping like with friends or something in that way and not really thinking things through. So taking actions that are really spontaneous in the moment, perhaps have this feeling of inspiration or spirituality, that where you're escaping from day to day life. And that's not really a big deal. We had that Venus conjunct the South Node a little while ago. And there's really like no like problem with that, with escaping the world for a little bit. Like we can all use an escape, but we do want to be careful with any reckless behavior, anything where we're going out and partying and doing anything dangerous. Like you want to make sure to have a designated driver. You want to make sure not to try anything brand new that's risky, because the element of danger is there. So the South Node is related to a demon. Also, you might see like imagery or information about demons, because like the other thing was just like when we had that Venus South Node, I swear to God, my husband got into just watching videos on demonology, and he doesn't know anything about the South Node or Ketu and Rahu. So I thought that was really interesting and really funny. But it could be things like getting lost in like Greek myths or something fun, or, you know, like something, you know, some, or like reading books all day. It's a very Sagittarius thing. Or even just being out in nature, wanting to be active. Like Sagittarius likes to keep their mind active as well as their physical body active, definitely. And in general likes to be like surrounded by the beauty of nature or the beauty of people or the beauty of music. Okay, and so this is gonna be a real competitive. It's continuing the theme on November 24th. On that Wednesday, we have Mercury ingressing Sagittarius. Now, what's important though, and the difference between the Sun in Sagittarius and Mercury in Sagittarius, is that Mercury doesn't do as well in Sagittarius and Jupiter ruled signs in general. So while the Sun is very much aligned with Jupiter and Sagittarius energy, Mercury is what is in what's called its detriment. And you can understand why when you guys just heard me talk about Sun in Sagittarius. So Sun in Sagittarius, very spontaneous, moved by their inspiration, doesn't really think things through ahead of time, just experiences it and learns from it after, versus Mercury, who he's the god of trickery and mischief. But another thing about him is that he plans things out step by step. So I told that story about how when he was a baby, he created the lyre out of the tortoise, like the instrument, and he stole Apollo's cattle and was super mischievous, right? So Mercury plans things ahead. A lot of times people think that Mercury ruled signs like Gemini and Virgo, Virgo less so, Gemini more so, are spontaneous. Like my husband's a Gemini sun, he has a lot of Virgo placements, and I would swear before I knew him that he was like super spontaneous, but not really. Like when I got to know him, he's always thinking, his mind is always on the go, and he's always planning things out step by step, like 20 steps ahead, thinking about every scenario and what he's gonna do. And it's a very detail-oriented sign and likes to plan things out. But the problem is that Sagittarius doesn't like to plan things out and is kind of at the beck and call of spirit, of inspiration. And that's kind of interesting if you think of the mythology of Mercury and Jupiter. So Mercury and Jupiter, with Sagittarius, remember, is the Jupiter ruled sign, the masculine sign of Jupiter. That's why I'm bringing up Jupiter and Mercury. So Jupiter and Mercury had really good fun together. They had a wild times, like when Jupiter got bored, he'd go hang out with Mercury. So it's not that they didn't get along, but it's more so in this sign that when Mercury is dealing with Jupiter, he is at the beck and call of Jupiter. So whatever Mercury had planned out goes out the window. Once the head honcho god comes down, Mercury needs to do whatever that god says and whatever that god says what to do, regardless of his plans. So basically Mercury in Sagittarius throws plans out the window because they're pulled away by a sudden inspiration. And so again, Sagittariuses love to talk about themselves. I have Mercury in Sagittarius natally, and I would definitely say I do have that experience. So you may have that experience possibly of like you make plans, you plan things out, and then spur of the moment, you just decide to do something fun that you're inspired by, like a friend calls or you see something cool, and you're just pulled away from your plans and you don't think things through. It's like, be careful not to leave the stove on if you're cooking and you get pulled away by a phone call or something interesting or something fun. Or like you plan to do some work, but then you get pulled away watching some kind of like fun video, or maybe astrology videos or tarot videos, if you like those, whatever the case may be. So being pulled out of your plans, and that makes perfect sense. If like, for example, if you're in the US, you know, we do have Thanksgiving coming up and the holidays coming up, even besides Thanksgiving. If you celebrate Christmas, even if you celebrate, you know, winter solstice or Hanukkah, I know there's lots of other holidays, so I apologize if I'm not naming all of them. Those are just the ones that are the most common around me that I'm thinking of. So it makes perfect sense, like in this season, that you'd be pulled away from your day-to-day, like droll work and being pulled to do something fun. But again, the warning is against escapism. So on Thursday, November 25th, we're then going to have Mercury conjunct the South Node, and the Sun is still conjunct the South Node. So generally, like, again, we have to worry about making plans that are escapist, you know, but I don't know if we have to worry about it. Like, you can experience it, have wisdom from it, but make sure that you know that there is like some element of like danger there with the escapism and with your plans, like spontaneous plans or like things that you're doing. Just make sure you're not doing anything like super dangerous or impulsive. Make sure that with the South Node influence, we want to escape the world, but we want to do it in a safe way. There's lots of safe ways to escape the world. You know, so again, like if you end up like reading books all day or getting lost in YouTube videos all day, or you know, you're playing music or you sleep all day, those are really not big things. But if you're going out partying with your friends, doing some risky activity, you know, like sex, any illegal substances, drinking, you know, like things along that nature, you really have to be careful, really be with people that you're close to and trust, because there's really this element of you're not going to be able to think things through. And so that can be an issue. The other thing that might come up that's coming to me is just that we might have communication again with Mercury coming through, bringing things up that are kind of dark or hidden or just like off-putting. So I'm thinking of about like, you know, like for example, in the news, there was like Afghanistan and just the awful situation there that I was like just crying about all the people there. This was a little while ago. That this was close to Venus conjunct the South Node. Yeah. And so I'm thinking there will be some light and dark themes as well. Really interesting, because we have the last quarter moon on Saturday, November 27th, and that's in Virgo. And Virgo does deal with, Virgo is like the earthy sign of Mercury, and it's actually going to be ruled by that Mercury in Sagittarius, which is moving out of the conjunction of the South Node. So this is where in the last quarter moon, it tends to be the phase of the moon where we have to let go of things, where we view like these maybe darker truths in life, the reality of life, but we have the maturity and the wisdom to let go in some way and be okay with life as it is. And so Virgo represents the earthy sign of Mercury that is able to navigate between realms and really look at the reality of things and find practical solutions with how to deal with the lighter and the darker themes of life. And Mercury, or the moon in Virgo, can be really self-sacrificing and giving to other people. Because at the end of the day, they want to do things that are practical, helpful, and that work. And there's also, again, Virgo is a Mercury-ruled sign, so there's this mischievous element also to our environment. And the last quarter moon, Virgos like to play innocent, but there's a very like mischievous quality. So sometimes Virgos are doing things and on a roll, and it's like they're doing things perfectly. They're almost like the perfect person, and they're heavenly, like that kind of feel to our environment. And then they're just awful and like causing issues and causing problems and being reckless and having reckless behavior. So I'm thinking maybe like there may be this element of self-acceptance and more acceptance for people in our environment, looking at their light and dark attributes and finding some harmony and peace in that, and also having this element of like embracing life as well, with it being ruled by that Mercury in Sagittarius, like having that theme of like we want to plan things out, but we know that circumstances in our life may pull us away from our plans. As I mentioned like earlier in the week, we may be pulled away from our plans to do something fun, to have an experience that gives us that tangible, practical wisdom, and accept that we have to let go sometimes of the things that we plan to do in order to do the things that the universe is calling us to do. Okay, and I want to actually do this transit for this week, even though this is going to be for next Sunday, November 28th, and it's continuing with the Mercury in Sagittarius theme, but it's going to be Mercury Kazemi in Sagittarius. So what that means is that Mercury is going to be right in the center of the sun. It's going to be lifted up by the sun as its special guest, and we're going to see a really clear version of what Mercury in Sagittarius looks like. Now, I talked a little bit about Mercury in Sagittarius earlier in this week, but one thing I want to bring up is that it's making a secret conjunction called an antitia with Pluto. So it's Mercury Kazemi has this secret conjunction with Pluto, and it makes me think of the Mercury in Sagittarius tendency to just say what they think and to bring up uncomfortable truths. So leading up to that Sunday, and maybe even on Sunday, it's going to be happening really early, like 5 a.m. So you probably more so see this like Saturday going into Sunday, which is why I'm including this transit for this week. Probably not going to include it for next week because it's just more so you're probably going to feel it more. We'll see. Anyway, you're going to see some dark truths, uncomfortable truths. So again, things that are dark, hidden under the earth, and it could be things that represent heaven or hell, things that you've pushed underneath, either your secret hopes and dreams, or things that you're really ashamed about, embarrassed, like things that you think that you've done wrong, like our sin, whatever, however you look at it, but really dark things that we thought we could push under the rug and keep it hidden. And Pluto's like, it's all coming up. So one thing I didn't mention earlier is just like you might have literal like plans or issues or communications about like plumbing issues, flooding, sewage problems, things where like like things are seeping up from under the earth. So you might see that in Mercury Kazemi with the secret Antitia, like literal problems, like with plumbing or sewage or things of that nature with your basement. It's basically that this Mercury Kazemi is going to help us to clear out our old debris, and really communicate, plan, like create action, based on things that are hidden underneath. That the Mercury in Sagittarius is a Jupiter ruled sign, it's going to put a spotlight on it. So again, Mercury in Sagittarius, Jupiter ruled sign, and Jupiter ruled morality and wisdom. And again, this like poetic justice. So we may see this like poetic justice happening, to things that are hidden, either our, you know, like our secret hopes and dreams, or our fears, things that we saw hidden. We see them come up, in order to see some like universal justice or poetic justice, just this feeling of, like justice was served, people got what they deserved, but it had nothing to do with the justice system. It's just the universe like corrected something itself. Okay, guys, I'm going to get into the reading for the week to give us some advice and guidance on what's happening. So I'm going to pull a card for the week that just summarizes the energy. Ooh, I like this. We have the Hermit to talk about the energy of the week. And I love this because I just talked about the last quarter moon in Virgo, and the Hermit represents Virgo. So, like the general energy of this week is wisdom is what is coming to mind, of going inward and reflecting and looking to find the light in the dark. But I have a feeling that it's not going to be as easy as that. Like there is this element of we might have some blinders on and not be able to see things as clearly as we want to. There may be this element of thinking that we found things that are our inner light, but that are deceptive in some way, that is not truly our light, that the things that we can see tangibly and touch are not the aspect of our light, but our inner light is something that is happening no matter what. So there's this element of we have to be careful not to think that someone has the answers for us or that escaping the world is an answer for us as we navigate through the week. Okay, so I had some cards just come out. So the advice for the week, we have the Five of Wands. We just had this last week, this card. And this is coming up, this inner battle. Like this inner battle to find the truth and see the truth. And yeah, that's what's coming up. Just this inner battle to find and to see the truth. Yeah, that's all I'm getting from this card, you know, this inner battle. And there might be some like fighting with other people, in a way, like, yeah, to find our truth. I don't know what, like, I'm keep trying to get more from this card, but that's it. That's all I'm getting from it. Sometimes I just get a little bit. Sometimes I get a lot from these cards. It really depends, you know, on what's going on. But we have this nice outcome on the, in the week. Like the outcome of the week is that we will find our inner light, with this Hermit. And we will like have this element of finding the truth and of good fortune. So this is a week that's really reflective where we're going inward. And we're really like finding things, that's nurturing to the soul, that lights up our soul, and things of good fortune and good feeling this week. So I'm really liking that. So I'm just going to go through mind, body, and spirit and see where we're going to be at. Minds, body, spirit, and just looking at how we can nurture ourselves during this week. So I like this inner, it's like this super grounded energy, even though we do have that deceptive quality with the South Node coming in. I think we're going to be feeling really good because we have the Six of Pentacles in our mind. And so this is a beautiful card that represents this like grounded energy, and things happening as they need to. So this element of justice, feeling like justice is served some way in this week, feeling secure and that things are going to be okay, really being able to handle our emotions and the things, that come up this week, and really reaching out for support. and like getting that support in some way, reaching out with our passions, having our desires met when it comes to our minds, and really having like a tangible, like full-bodied experience that makes our minds feel really secure. And then with our body feeling super grounded, we have the Queen of Pentacles energy, which came up. So really seeing other people really feel good and grounded in our bodies, having this maternal figure who's practical and grounded, really helping us nurture our bodies in some way, either teaching us ways to nurture our bodies, caring for us, like giving us advice, whatever it is, but that person, motherly, mature, very grounded, practical figure is going to be able to help us to feel good in our bodies. So it could be a partner, a mate, somebody maybe helping you to feel sensually and physically, physically nurtured. Or it could be a friend or a family member that's just checking in with you, helping you in some type of physical way so that you really feel grounded and awesome in your body. Love that. Like these cards, like there is this element, like again, of escapism, of not seeing things clearly, but at the end of the day, being okay. So it's a really like fortunate, nice escape. And then in our spirit, we have the Emperor reverse. So again, I think this really speaks also to our inner battles. And again, I'll take an image of this at the end of the video so you guys can see the cards. Yeah, but again, like this inner battle, we're not so much like reaching out to other people or fighting, but we're really looking within and seeing what's going on within and fighting our inner battles, but really feeling grounded, really having this light come out, and really fighting with, you know, a little bit of what's real and what's not, like having that energy, but overall feeling really good and super grounded and mentally able to handle things. Physically having people actually physically help us with what we need to do. Maybe with like Thanksgiving coming up, you know, we have like these motherly figures helping out with the meals and the plans and watching the kids or the pets or whatever needs to be done, maybe helping us at work so we can get out early, like this generally like festive feeling. And really pushing our spirit forward, that, you know, Sagittarius energy, Jupiter energy is all about the spirit being moved forward and being allowed to freely express itself. Okay, guys, as promised, here are some images of the cards. So this is the general energy of the week, the advice for the week, and the outcome. And then we also have mind, body, and spirit. So it looks like it's gonna be a good week. Happy Thanksgiving if you celebrate. And I will see you guys soon. Love you. Take care, bye. If you like this video, make sure to like, subscribe, and hit the bell to be notified for whenever I release a new video every single week.